Hello, Canada, and the world at large. This is Lane from Canada. When you take a moment to look at what other people have suffered through in life, you gain an appreciation for the first world privilege that people like me have. The past few years have been moderately bonkers, to be sure, but still the most I have to complain about now is how badly written and miscast Galadriel is.
Conflicted.
Even that affront to J.R.R. Tolkien's Legendarium is softened considerably by the knowledge that Amazon's The Rings of Power is going to go down in history as television's greatest financial disaster, and also by the hilarious fact that every pretentious actor who took part in it under the impression that it would be their ticket to the big time is going to have a pretty sparsely populated IMDb page moving forward. I've made that statement, and now I'm just going to leave it here for as long as the internet exists. So feel free to call me out in the future if Morfydd Clark, Super Gay Elrond, or Don Lemelis ever end up chronicled in the hallowed A-list rankings of John Wayne or Audrey Hepburn. See what I mean? That's as bad as my life gets. I talk about movies I love and make jokes about movies I hate. Less fortunate people all over the world have been betrayed by forces beyond their control and forced to take extreme measures just to survive. I mean, aside from the illnesses, accidents, and crimes we've been afflicted with historically, there are now people who have lost everything for posting a tweet or for being unjabinated. With that in mind, those of us who have the luxury of three squares a day and beaking off on YouTube have to temper our pop cultural complaints with good humor and a twinkle in the eye. Regardless of whatever personal struggles we've all suffered through, most of us have never been in the shoes of Danny Roman, a good cop who was framed by a bunch of bad cops for killing a cop. Seriously, what accusations have I ever faced to compare with that? I mean, there was that time that a random internet guy watched my review of another Samuel L. Jackson movie, Unbreakable, and accused me of being, and I quote, an obvious Jewish shill trying to ingratiate yourself with the blacks. I'm really not sure what tipped him off, the fact that I reviewed a movie where literally the only black guy was the bad guy.
They called me Mr. Glass.
Or the fact that I end every video with a very Jewish Orthodox, Jesus loves you. What I'm saying is I've got it really good and nobody's ever accused me of murder and I'm grateful for it. Welcome to Before Movies Sucked, and this is The Negotiator. In the mean streets of Chicago,
it's a trap!
CPD Lieutenant Danny Roman is a respected and highly skilled hostage negotiator, and is somehow much more convincing as a black guy with red hair than Disney's new Little Mermaid, which is going to lose a lot of money. See? There I go again! After a successful hostage rescue, Roman is privately approached by his partner and best friend, Nate Renick, to discuss an ongoing investigation into the department's disability fund, which has been embezzled more than $2 million. Nate says he has been in contact with an anonymous veteran of the force who has information on the theft, and claims that members of their own precinct are responsible. However, the source cannot go to internal affairs as he has evidence that one of their investigators, an inspector named Terrence Niebaum, may be involved. Roman is a board member of the disability fund, but admits that his own audits haven't come up with any evidence that can help the investigation. Later that night, Nate and Roman each receive a page telling the other to meet in a city park, but Nate is murdered before Roman arrives. Police officers arrive almost immediately to find Roman with Nate's body. An investigation led by Niebaum finds records of offshore accounts in Roman's home, with deposit amounts that match the most recent theft from the disability fund, forcing Police Chief Al Travis to remove Roman from duty. The district attorney and Roman's own lawyer tell him that he will absolutely be convicted of murder and embezzlement, and give him one day to name his co-conspirators in exchange for a reduced sentence. Realizing that he's being set up to take the fall for both crimes, Roman sends his wife Karen home, but stays behind in the city administration building, taking the elevator to the internal affairs office on the 20th floor. He confronts Niebaum, demanding to know what his role was in the conspiracy. When another officer draws his pistol, Roman disarms him and takes Niebaum hostage.
This is my life here, Niebaum. I want some answers.
I don't have any answers for you, Roman. Put the gun down and leave.
Oh, you don't feel like talking? Well, we're gonna stay here until you do. It's your choice.
Cause I'm not going to jail today.
After forcing the other officers to give up their weapons and leave, Roman secures Niebaum along with his assistant Maggie, a senior police officer from Roman's team named Frost, and a criminal informant named Rudy. Hey, that's Paul Giamatti!
Why are you always picking on me? I mean, who am I, Charlie Brown?
Roman's own team locks down the area. Roman's knowledge of their tactics allows him to secure the entirety of the IA offices, preventing the officers from seeing or hearing anything inside.
Farley would like to talk to you.
Tell him I only want to talk to Chris Sabian.
He'll only talk to Chris Sabian.
Tell him if Sabian's not here in 20 minutes, you die. I don't want to talk to anyone else but Chris Sabian.
Chris Sabian is a West Side negotiator who Roman barely knows. Knowing that it'll be almost impossible for him to make the deadline, Chief Travis instructs an officer named Farley to contact Roman and try to reason with him. Oh yeah, and then this happens.
Wait. You think you can talk me down for him?
I need to, tell me what you want, all right?
Okay, Farley. You want a shot? I'll give you a shot. Yeah. We got some time before Sabian gets here. Oh, what do I want? Let's see. How about, can I see a priest?
No, you can't see a priest.
That's good, Farley. That's good. You shouldn't let me see a priest. Because a priest is associated with death, and you don't want me thinking about death in my state now, do you?
No.
But you told me no, Farley. You can't say no. Never use no in a hostage situation.
Danny, would you relax a little bit?
Relaxed? I'm very relaxed. But let me give you some advice. Never say no to a hostage taker. It's in the manual. Now, are you going to tell me no again?
No, I'm not.
No, wrong answer. Eliminate no from your vocabulary, Farley. Never use no, don't, won't, or can't, all right? It eliminates options. The only option that leaves is to shoot someone. Understand?
Yes,
I do. Good. See, yes is good. If you say no again, I'll kill somebody, all right? Now let's practice. Can I see a priest?
Let's not. You know what? Can we just like talk?
You wanted
about this
to talk. Right? We are talking. Now, can I see a priest?
I'll see what I can do.
That's good, Farley. Now you're learning. I'd like a submachine gun so I can blow everyone away.
I'll look into that.
Realizing that they're outmatched, Chief Travis and Tactical Commander Adam Beck believe they'll have no choice but to initiate a full breach if Sabian fails to negotiate Roman's surrender and release of the hostages. They are further bothered by the presence of FBI negotiators, who agree to allow the CPD to continue their negotiations, but have the legal right to take over command at any time, as the administration building is federal jurisdiction.
Hey, schoolgirl. You still sweating that ugly display you gave us all a few minutes ago?
Stop kicking yourself in the ass. We all have our bad days. Beck.
Stop trying to figure out how to get in here. I'm pretty well bunkered. Palermo.
Take that toothpick out of your mouth.
Wouldn't want you to swallow it if something goes down.
That's right, sports fans. It's me, Danny Roman, the man upstairs. Just wanted to say hello before the curtain goes up on this little drama.
I guess you're all wondering why we're here.
Well, it's simple. We're here to
find out who took our money
and who killed Nate, because it wasn't me. There's some bad cops among us.
And today, we're gonna find out who they are.
Now, I need
you guys to understand that I had no choice here.
My life was being stripped away from me. First, they killed Nate. Then they took my badge. Then you guys.
Next.
They were going to take away my wife by sending me to prison. And that I cannot take. Another warning. I know the rules of engagement, so
don't test me. You got
4 minutes to get Sabian here, or you'll find out just how serious I really am.
Unable to arrive in time, Sabian bluffs by having his cell phone patched into the dedicated line, contacting Roman just before the deadline, and Roman gives him his list of demands. This includes having Nate's informant found within 8 hours, having Roman's badge returned to him, and a promise that Roman will be given a departmental funeral if he is killed in the siege.
I don't know if you're innocent or not. You could have done everything they say you've done. You could have killed that cop. I don't know, and I don't care. There are ways to prove your innocence. This is hardly one of them. And now you've got hostages. So let me tell you this. You hurt one of them, you're gonna burn up whatever currency you've got to deal with me. They're all I care about. You leaving here walking is a distant second. Now, do I make myself clear?
Good. Now we're getting somewhere.
Good. Now answer my question. What am I doing up here?
Before Nate was killed, he told me the men involved in the fraud are from my precinct. Guys I know. Guys I might call friends.
And?
And you're not. When your friends betray you, sometimes the only people you can trust are strangers.
While Roman is distracted talking to Sabian, Beck orders a breach through the office windows, but Roman is able to reach a standoff with the two HBT officers, Scott and Marcus. Team Sniper Palermo has an opportunity to kill Roman, which leads Scott and Marcus to feign surrender when they see his laser sight. But Palermo is unable to pull the trigger, remembering how Roman previously saved his life. With the breach failed, Roman takes the two officers hostage and accuses Scott of being one of the officers who killed Nate.
Are you one of them, Scott? One of the men that set me up? Is that why you want me dead?
Danny, it's me, Karen.
Danny, please talk to me.
Not come in here again.
After furiously demanding that full command be given to him to avoid another incident, Sabian threatens Roman with ending the negotiation, but Roman reminds him that the breach was ordered without Sabian's knowledge, making him suspect that someone may be attempting to silence Roman. Roman tells him he needs the building's electricity turned back on in order to access Nabom's computer files, and agrees to release Frost in exchange. Nabom's files reveal that Nate himself was the IA informant, and Rudy suggests that the embezzlement was most likely a form of insurance fraud wherein conspiring officers would submit false disability claims, but would need the collusion of a higher-ranking officer in order to access the funds and cover it up. Roman then bluffs over the radio that Nabom has confessed and will be naming names. Panicked by the knowledge that he is now as much of a target as Roman, Nabom confesses that Nate had identified three of the team's tactical officers, Hellman, Allen, and Argento, who had stolen money. However, when Nate reported this to IA, Nabom blackmailed the officers for a share of the money rather than turning them in. When Nate found out about this, he was killed. Knowing that Nabom can betray them, Hellman, Allen, and Argento have covertly infiltrated the air ducts above the office and opened fire after hearing Nabom implicate them. Roman is able to fight them off, but is too late to save Nabom, who is shot and killed, and his computer is destroyed. In the wake of the firefight, the FBI negotiators seize command and relieve Sabian, planning a full breach of the building. However, Sabian re-enters in a last-ditch effort to get Roman to surrender. Roman is accepting that he will most likely be killed, but Maggie tells him that Nabom worked extensively from his home, and copies of the evidence Roman needs will most likely be there. When Roman reveals that he only pretended to execute Scott and the officer is still alive, Sabian agrees to help him escape the building through the air ducts. As the building is breached and the hostage is rescued, Roman and Sabian escape the perimeter and drive to Nabom's house, but are pursued by the three guilty officers after Maggie confesses where Roman was going. Roman goads them into confessing their plan to kill him, covertly keying Sabian's radio to transmit the confession. However, they are interrupted by the arrival of Frost, who orders the officers to stand down and then locks them outside. Realizing that Frost is Nate's killer and the senior officer responsible for the thefts, Sabian takes Roman hostage to get him away from a window that Allen was about to snipe through. However, Sabian then shoots Roman and demands a cut of the money in exchange for destroying the evidence Nabom has on Frost. Frost agrees and goes outside to tell the arriving officers that Roman was killed.
Danny Roman's been shot. He's dead.
Let's get you some help. Come on, here we go. That's it, come on. Here you go.
We got an officer down in here.
Thank you. right to remain silent. If you give up the right to remain silent, anything you say can and will be used against you.
No!
You're not gonna get off that easy.
Roman has the opportunity to kill Frost and avenge Nate, but instead hands his weapon to Travis, surrendering himself. Beck and Sabian help him and Karen into the ambulance.
Sorry about that.
Nice bluff, Chris.
Well, it worked. Anyway, I figured you'd rather be shot by me than by him.
Before the ambulance leaves, Sabian fulfills Roman's last demand and returns his badge to him. When I was probably 5 years old, we were watching an old cop movie. I don't remember what it was, but I'll always remember a scene where the hero cop was being chased through the streets by several squad cars full of dirty cops. At the time, I didn't understand why the police would be chasing other police, so I asked my mom. She obviously felt that in my childhood innocence, I wouldn't comprehend the complexity of rampant corruption in a big city police precinct, so she just said, "Those are the bad police." The problem is, children tend to take things literally at that age. So I spent the next couple of years living in abject terror at the prospect of one day moving to a city where that sinister law enforcement arm officially designated the bad police operated. Also, my dad once told me that if I drank coffee before I was an adult, my ears would fall off. To be fair, those are probably the most traumatic experiences of my childhood, so again, I've got it really good. Thankfully, in my career of frequently working side by side with the police, I haven't run across any who were embezzling millions of dollars from their own wounded warriors, or murdering veterans to cover it up. Dang, I miss good movies about hero cops, and 90s cop movies were the best of the best. Forget superheroes, science fiction, and fantasy. If there's a film genre that truly needs a grand resurgence, it's the cop movie. The problem is, we can't get good cop shows anymore because Hollywood is terrified by the thought of everyday heroes being recognized for what they are. Self-sacrificing, generally male, and hyper-masculine. The blue-haired people aren't even afraid to admit that's why they stopped making shows and movies about police, just like they aren't afraid to admit how much they hate movies with patriotic representations of the US military. There are some truly great films in the mid-2000s, but there was also a notable uptick in films that villainized police and soldiers, and particularly assaulted their masculinity. Every film that came out was suddenly all about deep-rooted corruption in the force, or PTSD, or extraordinary rendition, or acts of wartime genocide, or
gay bathhouses, and it's all about round-the-clock sex. It's all, come on, man.
The resurgence of American patriotism in the immediate aftermath of 9/11 scared the ever-loving soy-based out of the blue-haired satanic commies who run Hollywood, and their attacks on heroes have been unrelenting ever since, mostly by reforging heroism into their own twisted image. And that is exactly why we now have Black Widow committing genocide against a Siberian prison camp in a scene that Disney Marvel honestly thought would make us stand up and cheer.
If you wipe out a Siberian prison camp, you might as well be dropping a mountain on Alexander Solzhenitsyn.
Girls get it done.
Ah! Feminist cringe overload! Cut to random hot chicken revealing swimwear.
You want a hot body? You want a Bugatti? You want a Maserati? You better work.
Hollywood hates heroes. They canceled freaking Cops after who knows how many seasons because it was consistently making viewers, you know, like, respect, and understand the hardships of cops. Then there was Brooklyn Nine-Nine, one of the greatest sitcoms I've ever seen. When recommending it to friends, I frequently told them it was one of the few shows I've seen that never had a bad episode, even in the first season when most shows are still working out the kinks. The show was eventually canceled, and that should have been the end of it. A great show with an intact legacy. Then George Floyd died in 2020, and the blue-haired people actually revived the series for one more season so that the beloved characters could come back and officially apologize to the world for being cops. Suffice it to say, Brooklyn Nine-Nine now has bad episodes, and an official legacy of, well, that sucked. Unlike me, apparently, these people never know how good they've got it.
Who do we call when we're in trouble and someone has a knife or a gun?
I wouldn't call the police.
Why wouldn't you call the police?
I don't trust them.
That smug bitch would 100% call the police. She would call the police and she would scream, "Send all the police!" Here's a more likable Texas Belle showing you how to barbecue.
Hey y'all! Today I am showing you how to make a smoked breakfast fatty. And now to create the bacon weave, we're using hot and spicy breakfast sausage. Take the eggs we just cooked up. Ooh, ready for the smoker. It is perfect! Oh my gosh.
The Negotiator is a fantastic showcase of old-fashioned heroism in the character of Danny Roman, a man who was forced to do unthinkable things that could easily lead him to forfeit his innocence. One wrong step could lead to the death of police officers and civilians, and Roman knows that such a catastrophe would be entirely on his hands, not the corrupt officers who forced his actions. Everything he does is with the intention of seeking truth, preserving his righteousness, finding justice for his murdered friend, and protecting the love of his wife, the latter of which he cites as being his primary motivation. That is the opposite of toxic masculinity. Roman's journey is a true tightrope walk, particularly when he is forced to fake the execution of Scott, which he knows will only unite the good cops with the bad in their efforts to kill him. This scene works perfectly in the film, as Samuel L. Jackson had already played Roman as hot-tempered and reckless, despite his elite training and real-world experience. We know he didn't murder Nate, but in the light of a seemingly unforgivable act, there is a genuine question as to whether or not we have been misled in our allegiance to Roman. However, by that time, the movie has wisely introduced us to the fantastic character of Chris Sabian, so we still have a hero to fall back on, and we think we're in the middle of a truly great twist. And in the end, our sense of elation is palpable when Roman reveals the final twist that Scott is still alive. We had our doubts, along with every other cop in the movie, but in the end, we are more than rewarded for our hope that heroes can still exist. One of the things that always impresses me about The Negotiator is that the plot is actually quite simple once the mystery is unraveled, but it's also some of the most intelligent writing I've ever seen in a police action movie. For example, the Roman vs. Farley scene has been mirrored in dozens of lesser films. It's an obvious setup to show how intelligent and experienced the hero is, but it's done so much better than other famous examples such as John McClane vs. the buffoonish Deputy Chief Dwayne T. Robinson in Die Hard. The point of how Farley, and by proxy the entire police force, is clearly outmatched by Roman is hammered home very efficiently, but it's not done in a way that diminishes or dehumanizes Farley, and it actually leads to one of the most genuine emotional reactions I've ever seen in a film.
Oh. All right, everybody, calm down. I'm so sorry.
One of my favorite scenes in the movie is Roman's interrogation of Niebaum, where he mocks the corrupt inspector for not knowing basic skills of lie detection. It's a great but simple way of pointing out that the difference between a good cop and a bad cop is how much dedication a good cop is willing to invest into discovering the truth, while a bad cop is content to coast by on his own self-interest.
You're lying. And I know you're lying.
Oh, you know it, huh? Well, you read my mind, Roman, is that it?
No, I'm not. I'm reading your eyes. The eyes can't lie. Didn't you know what I was doing? A quick lesson in lying. See, this is what us real cops do. We study liars. Example. If I ask you a question about something visual, like your favorite color, and your eyes go up and to the left, well, neurophysiology tells us that your eyes go in that direction because you're accessing the visual cortex. Therefore, you're telling the truth. If your eyes go up and right, then you're accessing the creative centers of the brain, and we know you're full of shit.
For the record, that eye trick works. I came up with a test where I would tell a friend they had to pick a number between 1 and 4, but not tell me what it was. I would then ask them 4 personal questions requiring basic memory recall, and they had to lie in response to the unknown question number that they had decided on. I would then have to tell them which question they had answered with a lie. I caught the lie every time as their eyes accessed the creative side of the brain rather than the visual cortex while formulating their response. Fun little party game. One thing that can never be underestimated in film is the power of a one-on-one cat-and-mouse conversation. We've examined this before in this series with Captain Kirk vs. Khan in Star Trek II, and Kimball vs. Gerard in The Fugitive. But The Negotiator is probably my all-time favorite example. When Roman tells Sabian,
"This is our first date, Chris. The courting period."
It feels exactly like that. It's a dance of wits, it's a fishing expedition, and it's a testing of boundaries all at the same time. And when you hear it coming from two cinematic masters like Samuel L. Jackson and Kevin Spacey, it becomes the single greatest elevator of the film.
Oh, so now you're some kind of history buff.
Yeah, I generally read histories and biographies.
Well, don't believe everything you read in books.
Well, I didn't say I read just one book. I try to read all the books on a subject. And I'll try to get all the facts and then decide for myself what really happened.
Mm-hmm. Get all the facts, huh? Yeah, that's smart. You're much better at this than Farley, you know?
Even the opening credits here are particularly great. For one thing, Graham Revel's score is fantastic, but the subtlety of the images is what makes it one of my favorite credit sequences. Even if it's just black and white stills of Danny and Karen's wedding, the fact that we are shown every traitor in the department in attendance really hammers home their subsequent betrayal. The fact that all the murderers are also shown joining in the festivities at Chief Travis's birthday party along with their families makes them all the more human and all the more chilling. It's a reminder to us that the truest form of evil doesn't wear a black hat, and it further validates Roman's need to reach out to a stranger in order to find out who he can trust. Speaking of that stranger, Chris Sabian is the pinnacle of Kevin Spacey's career to me. He obviously moved on to far more commercially successful and critically acclaimed roles in the decades since, but favorites are going to favorite, and this is my favorite of his countless roles. Sabian is a great contrast to Roman, seeming far more calm and gentle in his first appearances, while clearly being his intellectual equal. The few moments where he has to use his dad voice to secure command of the scene from Beck, or even to put Roman in his place, are great examples of where the strength of a man truly lies. Nobody in history has ever looked at Kevin Spacey and felt physically intimidated by him, except maybe a few 14-year-old boys. And Sabian is absolutely chilling when his hand is forced.
One more gun goes off, and I'm gonna give the order to move in myself, you understand? Don't think you've bought anything by asking me to come here. Because you need to remember, I am a stranger to you. You have no idea what I'm capable of.
I am several inches taller than and half again the size of Kevin Spacey, and that line alone made me think, dang, I do not want to mess with Chris Sabian. Could this movie be made today?
A Nibom told me Nate was his informant. Yes, he worked for IAD. Worked for Nibom all
Danny.
Along. He was describing himself. He just didn't want me to know.
Melanin quotient of the film's characters is never mentioned and does not influence the progression of the story in any way, because racism was basically a bygone in 90s cinema until BLM, Antifa, and a bunch of white liberals brought it back.
All white people are racist.
No. According to some people, I look fat in ski clothes.
No, look, that's not the word she used. No, she used a much worse word.
Despite winning an Oscar for his own super gay role in Philadelphia, Tom Hanks recently stated that it is no longer acceptable for heterosexual actors to play homosexual characters because apparently Tom Hanks no longer remembers what the word acting means. However, he has the full support of the blue-haired people on that one, and it's tit for tat to assume that the vice versa is also applicable, so Kevin Spacey with a wife and kid is right out the window unless he decides to flip a switch in order to get his career back.
I'm not gay no more. I am delivered.
You ever dress up like a schoolgirl and get your bank borrowed?
I'm just going to call this one presented without comment, because the only appropriate way to follow up the blue-haired people's problematic rationale would be with a cringe-inducing video clip of Dylan Mulvaney, and literally every conservative commentator has already got that one covered. Stop putting Dylan Mulvaney in video thumbnails. His face is clogging up my YouTube homepage. One of the hardest decisions in life is determining the appropriate reaction to a blatant injustice, and every one of us can think of a time when we definitively made the wrong choice in the face of one. I've thought about what my response would be to facing arrest for charges that I know to be false, or, much more disturbingly, facing arrest for violating an immoral law that my conscience will not allow me to obey. Even in privileged nations founded on individual freedoms, those are real decisions that many of us will absolutely have to make one day, and some already have. Once again, it's a reminder that heroes are determined not by what they can punch through, but by what they are willing to sacrifice in order to maintain their own integrity and the values that are more than worth dying for. Roman's extreme action of taking hostages and forcing the truth out of them may seem a little more viscerally cathartic than would be appropriate in his situation, but there's still something truly admirable in seeing a man knowingly lay down his own life rather than being unjustly separated from his wife. No matter how many blue-haired commies overrun Hollywood and even our federal governments, our nations can still survive and triumph, so long as we remember that God, family, country is a heck of a lot more than just a cute catchphrase. Anyway, should Christ tarry, I'll see you in the next video. Jesus loves you, vote Lane for King of Canada. I'm seriously grateful that my greatest adversity thus far in life was an incident known as the Really Big Spider of 87. And let's make movies great again.
endangered species list.
Come on, man.